So first of all, thanks a lot for the invitation. I'm very glad to be here. And I will try to not to speak very fast, but if it happens, let's just do like this, and I will calm down. And the same with Italian. If you don't understand my accent, let's do like this, and I realize that I'm not audible enough. So let's start with this picture. As you see, yes, my surname, Raimondo, and probably you like any similarity because he's my brother. And yes, actually he's a gynecologist, and his twin brother is gynecologist, and my father is gynecologist, and I am artist. And actually it happens that my brother 1 year ago send me this picture on WhatsApp, say, ah, this is my new conference. And when I see this title, I became crazy. It's Nuove Frontiere del Benessere dell'Ecosistema Vaginale, New Boundaries of the Well-Being of Vaginal Ecosystem. So now, if I was in radio, I will just ask you, what do you think if I say new boundaries of well-being of the vaginal ecosystem? And I will leave a silence, and I will imagine your answers. I'm here with you, so I will directly tell you what it opens to me. New boundaries, for me, it's really to open up the established, framed boundaries that we have the habit to deal with. And then I will come back on boundaries in geographies. Well-being, for me, it's one of the reasons why, it's one of the motor why I'm feminist, because it's the possibility of social equality, it's one possibility of social equality. And vaginal ecosystem for me is a very powerful combination of words, because it could be a kind of ocean of feminisms. For me, the vagina, of course, is a metaphor, it's not the literal sense of it. So yes, vaginal ecosystem more like a meeting point of different feminism and gender perspectives. And actually, when I took it more seriously, this title, I started to dive into urban geography, geography more a kind of academic area. And of course, I start to be very interested in feminist geography. And I discovered that women have been and continue to be marginalized as producers of geographical knowledge. And in 1984, the first and still the only book-length overview of geography and gender was published, and it is now out of print. So I took as a kind of Bible a book which is called Feminism and Geography by Gillian, I'm sorry, Rose. It's quite dated, but it's very, very inspiring. And in this book, actually, one of the first statements she does is that geography is masculinist, because while claiming to be exhaustive, forgets about women's existence and concerns itself only with the position of men. Masculine geography holds a series of unstated assumptions about what men and women do, and that the discipline concentrated on the spaces, places, and landscapes that it sees as men's. Masculine geography generates concepts to organize its knowledge in order to exclude what it saw as women's issue. And a typical example is, for example, the reproduction issue, no? And so the separation between what is public and private. Masculine work claims to be exhaustive, and it therefore assumes that no one else can add to its knowledge. It is therefore reluctant to listen to anyone else. So I started from this. And of course, a lot of other questions arise. So, for example, what does it mean and imply to be woman once assumed that is not a biological issue? What does it mean to be or behavior as woman in the public space? And I think that it's very central to me, this question of visibility and invisibility in the public space, and we will come back later on it. how the urban space responds to women and how to map a place according to gender perspectives. So those are really the focus, the central questions that lead this research, because I didn't tell you that actually now new boundaries of the well-being of vaginal ecosystem is really an ongoing project that I'm trying to decline, articulate in different geographies in which I spend time with women. So, actually, with this research, is of course an artistic, aesthetic research, but it's really also an attempt to go toward as what I'm kind of defining affective and bodily and embodied geography. So a geography which is told and mapped by voices, a geography made of significant places. I think that this adjective significant is very central to me, because actually its place is invested by intimate memories, friendly and hostile places according to our daily life and our perceptions. A geography which is made of our bodies and experiences, a geography made of subjectivities, presences, and present, a geography which takes in account the multiplicity of gender perspectives. So, this is the very beginning of new boundaries of na 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 na. The very first time was in Rome, in a gallery which is called Ex Electrofonica, but actually all the project was made out of the gallery. And what I did is to interview like more than 10 women, very, very different from them. So for example, there was Elena Velena, who is a kind of queer porno activist. Then there was Elisabetta Canitano, who is a gynecologist, very activist in the 68 and now on pro-abortion in Rome, and this is very urgent and important. Or, for example, young woman more involved in squat and out-organization collectives. And actually, they helped me to map the city of Rome. And yes, so this was the map that we come out with their experiences. And for example, it's nice because there are kind of some morphological aspects of the city, the cobblestones. I don't know if you see the ground, which is kind of, doesn't work. Ah, yes. That is actually very not comfortable at all with women who decide to put heels. Or, for example, a lot of women spoke to me about the river, that it was a very significant place for them for different reasons. Or, of course, the presence of the Vatican as the big enemy. And so on. And I would like to, and actually in the gallery it became so an installation, multi-channel installation, where my challenge was to keep the unicity of each voice, but to put them in dialogue between them and with the soundscape I was recording after. And actually, I would like you to listen an excerpt.
Di camminare coi tacchi alti per la strada faceva perdere il controllo sul territorio e quindi era un'esperienza estremamente stimolante.
Io mi ricordo la fasciata di San Pietrini e tutto quello che c'era di mezzo ai San Pietrini, quindi non so, io ho delle immagini di
entrare in un ruolo di pericolo, di quasi come se fossi un animale predato nella giungla.
A Carnevale, a Piazza Navona, con tutti i coriandoli nei San Pietrini colorati.
Roma è una città, la Roma antica soprattutto, è una città da questo punto di vista antifemminile, perché camminare sui San Pietrini è un'esperienza abbastanza terrificante.
Passavamo nei mercati, anche rionali, in centro, e vedevano i San Pietrini, la verdura, le carote, la buccia, le cose.
Più lenta riesci a vedere. Vedi le persone e le persone ti vedono. Io trovo sempre i soldi per terra in bicicletta. Quando vai in bicicletta vai più lento. Io dico che alla fine in realtà vai alla giusta velocità a cui deve andare una persona, un essere umano. Mi fa molto femmina la bicicletta, non saprei spiegarti, ma
Angelo onda nascosto le ali. Roma è come un amante bellissimo che ti cosparge di miele, di bellezza e che poi all'improvviso ti schiaffeggia.
Roma per me è come una madre, una moglie, una fidanzata, un marito, un pappone, uno strozzino.
Roma è una città molto femminile, secondo me, perché Roma è
battona, meretrice e anche un po' volgare, ecco, sguaiata.
Roma è una città barocca e quindi di punti di fuga.
Sicuramente sento accoglienti.
Da cogliere nelle pieghe. La piega è barocca, ma la piega è femmina.
Genuinamente decadente.
Tra via del Quirinale e via delle Quattro Fontane c'è
come se lasciassero
questa chiesa,
come se facessero spazio,
che si vede soltanto perché c'è una specie di corrugamento del muro.
Mi tira sempre un pochino giù, invece di su sarebbe Piazza San Pietro.
Ma te puoi girare per una città in cui ci sono solamente preti che te guardano male, suore che sono timide, abbassano lo sguardo, ma certo se sei strana ti guardano male pure loro, e poi tutti questi negozi con i vestiti per preti, come il film di Fellini, Roma, quello che alla fine c'è la sfilata di moda per preti con questi vestiti spaziali. Allucinante! No!
Io entravo in via della Conciliazione, mi trovavo davanti il cupolone del Vaticano, acceleravo spingendo a tavoletta e andavo a tutta velocità immaginando che in cima alla macchina, come se fosse stato un pick-up della Toyota con un RPG montato sopra, avrei sparato un missile contro il cupolone per distruggere questo nemico, come dire attenzione per...
Because here I can sit. Sorry. Ah, you are here, sorry. Sorry, sorry. How much time I still have? Okay. Okay, yes. So I will put it from here. Sorry. Voilà. I will put it, no?
Distruggere questo nemico, come dire, attenzione perché il vostro nemico è qui, io sono presente.
Di un ospedale religioso le ha chiesto quanti uomini ha avuto nella sua vita.
I luoghi maschilisti a Roma, secondo me, in primis sono i bar.
La piazza del Parlamento.
In queste vie che si incrociano, squadrate.
Credo che questi posti finanziari delle banche, i business center, di quelli dell'Eur,
che tentano di razionalizzare per forza lo spazio.
C'è questo obelisco molto grande.
Sono molto maschili. Gli autobus, la metropolitana, la velocità, i motorini, le strade, quello è molto maschile. Quindi ti si butta addosso, è aggressivo come la mascolinità, no?
È il tunnel che collega San Lorenzo a Piazza Vittorio ed è un punto in cui anche si sente che è proprio questa zona di transizione tra i due quartieri, no? Quindi sono un po' questi non luoghi in cui senti che potrebbe anche succedere qualcosa, perché non è un luogo di sosta, quindi non è un luogo dove qualcuno può essere veramente testimone.
So this is an excerpt of the yes, new boundaries in Rome, and as I told you at the very beginning, actually, and for me it could be like the project of my life. Actually, I'm starting also a PhD oriented to this kind of research, and the second time I had the the possibility to articulate this project was in Valparaíso in Chile in the frame of a festival which is called Tsunami. And again, I had the chance to meet different women, different feminisms, because it was very varied, and it was very important also, again, for me to be in touch with different gender perspectives, let's say. And again, it was very funny because in the interview comes up some characteristic, for example, the wind, il vento, that it's quite complicated for women sometimes because the skirt can fly. But also, for example, the lack of public toilets, very, very kind of functional also aspects of the city. And again, the presence of the sea for each interview, it was very, very central. I don't know if it's something that could be a kind of conclusion, but it's something interesting that also comes back to water. And in that case, I articulate a sound walk. So it was really to go in specific places that these women told me. In group, we had headphones and we follow those voices and eventually their instructions to fill the space according to their experience. And also here, I would like you to listen to a little excerpt.
En esta cotidianidad de la gente que se pone en la calle a vender, no sé, pues verdura, tontera, lente, paraguas en invierno, no sé. Hay mucho juego de color en Valparaíso, una ciudad muy llena, pero no muy llena en términos como de hay mucha gente, sino muy llena en el sentido de variada.
Mira, yo me siento muy a gusto en Valparaíso porque es una ciudad donde cabe todo el mundo. Me encanta. Es una ciudad donde... Bueno, transitamos nosotras, lo que puede llamarse las feministas, mujeres educadas, mujeres que venimos de otros lugares, mujeres blancas o mujeres bien vestidas, o transitamos negros, negras, transitamos gente pobre, transitamos gente muy repobre, gente que vive en la calle. Me gustó, pero con locura, hacer caminar a mis hijos y hacerlos crecer en un lugar donde comprábamos las frutas en el mismo lugar que los travestis. Me fascinaba vivir en una ciudad donde yo le podía decir a mis hijos, mira qué entretenido, mira, es travesti, baja con sus chanclas, con su maquillaje, con sus rulos en la cabeza porque está cocinando y después va a trabajar o qué sé. Pero me parecía maravilloso que mis hijos pudieran crecer en ese mundo y que yo pudiera enseñarles a no tenerle miedo a la gente distinta. Y sigue siendo así.
Y Valparaíso tiene esa cosa de que te inspira a ser.
A mí me encanta Valparaíso, me encanta su arquitectura natural, más que su arquitectura creada o construida, porque también todo es muy colonial, entonces tengo conflictos con eso, pero su arquitectura natural, el ser cerro, por ejemplo, y que el cerro sea como un mirador natural hacia el mar, eso me fascina. El caminar y bajar rápido por los cerros, como que esas cosas me encantan habitarlas y las disfruto mucho.
En Valparaíso igual vivimos sobre cuarzos, como que los roqueríos de las playas, como de las torpederas principalmente en Playa Ancha, es puro cuarzo. Entonces creo como que a nivel energético igual debe haber una influencia de que quizá una viva como de manera tan intensa esta ciudad.
Entonces es fea, es cochina. Yo sé, a mí eso no me importa nada. Me importa que es una ciudad donde podemos estar todos cómodos, donde no hay que estar tan bien vestida para salir. Me encanta que puedo salir en pijama a comprar el pan. Me importa un rábano, voy en pijama a comprar el pan. Y saludo, oh, vine en pijama, qué sé yo, y me saludan y después vuelvo más tarde. Ya me duché, vengo a comprar el pan de nuevo. Eso, es cómoda.
Mira, a ver, Valparaíso para mí es una mujer de brazos y piernas muy formadas y muy desarrolladas, grandes. Como es una mujer chilena, es una mujer de pelo negro, largo, que le tapa la cara con el viento. Se mueve mucho, pero no es que baile, sino que sus movimientos son graciosos. Como el tiempo es muy benigno, nosotros no tenemos ni veranos muy calurosos ni inviernos muy fríos, porque el mar es el gran compañero de esta señora. Entonces, anda siempre como ligera de ropa, o sea, tú puedes notar sus formas a través de la ropa.
Valparaíso es mujer. Es mujer porque es mar, y la mar siempre va a ser mujer.
Tengo muy relacionado a Valparaíso con el mar. Entonces, por ese lado, quizás como una especie como de marinero o navegante.
Yo siento que Valparaíso es una ciudad muy dual.
Sí, o sea, yo creo que Valparaíso podría ser mujer y hombre, va a ir cambiando según incluso tu estado de ánimo.
Valparaíso creo que es una ciudad travesti.
Valparaíso es trans.
Es una ciudad travesti porque se viste de lo que sea. O sea, puede ser la capital institucional, donde está el Congreso, el Ministerio de Cultura y qué sé yo, pero donde están todos los puticlubes, donde están las mejores fiestas.
Es una ciudad llena de contradicciones, porque es una ciudad extremadamente kitsch, y eso a mí me produce una ternura inmensa, porque amo el kitsch, lo amo, porque tiene una estética molestosa, porque es sudaca.
Voilà, so, come back to my presentation, voilà, yes, so this was in Valparaíso, and now the new step is in Brussels, and I had the chance to start it with the QO2, and it will be really a long-term project this time, not like 3-4 weeks of residency, but I really want to take time. And this time I would like to actually to start from the act of listening. So what if we produce a map made by our listening acts as women citizens? What could the act of listening reveal about our relationship with urban space? And how does listening play a role in defining a place more or less friendly or hostile? Collectively, and so what I did in QO2 last Sunday with other people, it was a kind of collective experimentation in which we record our perceptions of the public space by making individual and collective derive, focusing on listening. So keep in mind the question, how gendered is our listening and how this impacts the value we give to the place and the experience of it. And so this time in Brussels, the intention is to map again subjectivities within the city, and ideally I would like to realize a sonic maquette, I don't know how it's in English, and I put it in French, of the city, but with a kind of the ideal Brussels for women. And yes, and then probably, I don't know if I will have time to show you another video, but I'm not speaking about an artist, I'm speaking really about a woman of the day, in the daily life, and a lot of people ask me, including my father and my brother, but why are you feminist, you are doing whatever you want, and a lot of other people, not just my parents and my brothers, and again, as also as a kind of artist activist, why do I still think that it is necessary to activate moments of reflection and production of knowledge made by women for women, or whom feels women? And I will really kind of not conclude, but finish my presentation, if I don't have time to show the video, we will see, with this. In this last workshop in Brussels, we use the derive as a tool, no, of experimentation. And so I would like really to focus on this word, the masculine of flaneur, flaneuse, from the French. Feminine form of flaneur, a needle, I don't know if I pronounce it right, dawdling observer, usually found in cities. This is an imaginary definition, it doesn't exist. And you can find it in a wonderful book, Flaneuse, by Lauren Elkin. Actually, in the Dictionnaire Vivant de la Langue Française, flaneuse means a long chair. Or for many people, it reminds a street walker, which for someone evokes prostitution. So this could be one of the reasons why I'm still feminist. And the other day was very interesting because we really discussed also this word, no? Because words are important. So far, I didn't find another word that could replace feminist. So if you have any ideas, any suggestion, probably we could also speak about it later. But yes, I really do think that we have really, everyone has to resist and activate alternative ways of knowledge and practices. But as women, I think we have more to do. And so the role of listening in all this research. Of course, listening as a sharing and meanings negotiation of time-space. And I missed Manuela's presentation yesterday, but I have the chance to speak with Caroline and Ludo. And you problematized this word of participation. And I work a lot with participatory practices, but for me as well, it's quite complex. I prefer to speak about the relational potential of listening because it gives more freedom to take positions within it, I think, I don't know. And yes, the role of listening again, as you say, I don't know your name before, listening can have a lot of adjectives that we can combine and it really oscillates in meanings. No, this is very wonderful. So for me, for example, when I decide to listen, there is always a critical and political practice within it that reveals also the ideologies with which I listen. And I think this is very central to this project as well. Listening, which activates listening. And this is central for me as well, because we were speaking about resonance. But for me, actually, listening, which activates listening, makes me think a lot about disturbing, provoking, contaminating, infiltrating, alterating, that is not written in the right word. And of course, and overall, I think that I work with listening. Before I was defining myself radio art, then I say, no, probably I'm a sound artist. Now I don't know what I am, but I'm sure that I work with listening because there is no listening without listeners. And for me, this is central because it always reminds me that I'm a relational person, no? So that I'm always, as Brandon was saying before, subject to transformation, a subject in constant transformation through the meetings and the relations I have. And if we have time, this Chiara could tell me, I would like to show you a video that was the first project I made in Brussels. You will see I was younger. It is in probably 2014, and it's called Encouragement.
Queridas, amigas y compañeras de la vida. À un moment donné, moi déjà j'avais senti l'œuvre d'art comme une possibilité de rencontre. Tout ça est un renoncement. Toujours essayer, toujours rater, peu importe. Il faut que tu réessayes, il faut que tu rates, il faut que tu rates mieux.
L'échec peut être tout un style, en fait.
C'est le meilleur signe que tu vas dans la bonne direction. Non, je parlais au téléphone. Non, je parlais au téléphone. En fait, peu importe ce que la gente te rapproche, pousse-le vraiment au maximum parce que c'est toujours toi. En fait, je pense que si qui ne bouge pas ne peut pas se rendre compte des propres chaînes. Mais comment on peut savoir si un trou, s'il n'y a pas les bords? Je pense que les regrets blessent les rachettes. Et ça, en fait, en marseillais, ça veut dire qu'il ne faut pas avoir de regrets dans la vie. En fait, je trouve que si tu t'aimes pas toi-même, c'est très difficile de te sentir aimé. Ouais. A pechuga y padelante. Il faut que tu lasses la magie de la Provence, parce que tu as le corps prêt pour les risques, la tête prête pour l'inconnu et les ailes pour voler très haut. Donc il faut que tu laisses la Provence. Mais en fait, je pense qu'une vie vécue dans la peur, c'est une vie vécue à moitié. Avant d'être deux, il faut savoir être un ou une. Eh bien, rien t'oblige à te marier. Rien. Tu ne dois pas être jolie. Tu ne dois pas ta beauté à personne. Ni à ton copain, ni à ton épouse, ni aux gens que tu rencontres dans la rue. Tu ne dois pas ta beauté ni à ta mère, ni à ton fils, ni à la société tout court. En fait, la beauté, ce n'est pas un loyer à payer pour occuper une place marquée femme. Les femmes sont belles, fortes et courageuses. Et en fait, les femmes sont en constante métamorphose parce que leur corps contient l'essence du devenir. Je pense que les femmes doivent penser à elles-mêmes comme des prédatrices, pas comme des victimes. Je suis dégoûtée par l'idée que les femmes doivent devenir invisibles quand elles sont dans la rue. Vraiment, je trouve ça horrible. Et ça doit changer, ça doit changer. L'attitude est la première chose. Peu importe que tu t'affines pour l'autodéfense, pour un pistolet, l'attitude doit être là. Tu as du courage, vraiment. Et je ne fais rien de spécial que d'accompagner pour la victoire totale, vraiment. Et ne te lasse pas embêter par les garçons, vraiment. Et ne doute jamais de tes capacités. N'oublie pas, en fait, que tu es forte et que chaque obstacle est là pour te faire développer encore plus. En fait, je veux que tu sois une femme forte, solide et libre. Tu as confiance en elle. Il faut juste que tu travailles. Et tu vas voir qu'à un moment donné, les choses vont se débloquer. Prends bien soin de ta santé, parce que sans la santé, il n'y a rien. Il n'y a rien. Mais en fait, je pense aussi aux femmes auxquelles c'est interdit de se masturber beaucoup plus qu'aux hommes. En fait, ça, c'est une autre forme de contrôle. C'est vraiment une autre forme de contrôle. Mais en fait, si les femmes pouvaient profiter de leur corps, de leur sexualité, de leur plaisir, ça serait déjà les 50% du combat, honnêtement. Mais en fait, tu veux savoir quoi? Moi, je pense que la masturbation peut apporter des choses que la réalité ne peut pas combler. En fait, si les femmes pouvaient vivre avec elles-mêmes et se satisfaire, elles pourraient aussi satisfaire les autres. Mais oui, en fait, l'abstinence, ça va générer des problèmes, violence, frustration, cruauté, c'est clair. En fait, si tu aimes le sexe, ne t'épuise pas, c'est tout. Mais tu savais qu'en fait, les femmes ont la capacité d'avoir des orgasmes de 3 heures et les hommes une seule heure, que les femmes peuvent vraiment contribuer à améliorer la sexualité globale, quoi. Ouais. Non, mais tu sais, je trouve scandaleux qu'en fait les 30% de la population mondiale des femmes n'a jamais eu un orgasme. C'est incroyable, c'est vraiment... Tu me demandes pourquoi le sexe est tellement important. En fait, le sexe est comme un sédatif. T'aides à dormir, le sexe te permet de combattre les addictions. Moi, m'a aidé à arrêter de fumer, figure-toi. Augmente la concentration. En fait, le sexe t'aide à rajeunir, à te réchauffer pendant l'hiver. C'est très bien pour la santé. C'est très bien pour la santé parce que t'aide à la santé cardiovasculaire aussi. Le sexe crée aussi l'intimité. Le sexe sert aussi à éviter de travailler. Moi, je pense que la plus grande partie des gens est plus seule avec d'autres personnes qu'avec eux-mêmes. Ouais. Je pense que le secret pour une relation durable, c'est réaliser que l'autre personne n'est pas là à réaliser tes propres désirs, tes propres objectifs. Si après tes objectifs et tes désirs sont clairs, vous pouvez coexister. Je n'ai pas dit cohabiter. Le respect et la liberté, ça doit être une priorité. Donc, si tu veux le faire, fais-le. Quand tu, comme femme, tu arrives à te nourrir, à t'encourager, à te donner du pouvoir, de la force, de l'amour, quand tu peux te nourrir et tu peux t'encourager, alors là, tu peux commencer à te développer.
Mamma. Mamma.
Mamma. Mamma. Mamma. Allez, on y va. On souffle maintenant. On souffle, on souffle.
On souffle maintenant. Stop. Stop. Encore. 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 Stop. On souffle. Maintenant.
C'est bien, c'est bien, c'est bien. Je vois ces chevaux.
Okay, so I'm the last one.